Good morning. It's me, Bobby E, with the big voice. such a big voice that today I'm going to turn the devotional, the short devotional, over to Mr. Pastor Tim Keller, because this guy doesn't have much of a voice to do the talk today. But I thought before we did that, we should probably pray for our province. BC's in a lot of pain right now, you guys. You guys know that. You're watching the news. You can see the amazing suffering going on with flooding, and people have lost their homes, their cars, they're stuck. My friend Jeff is a pastor in Hope, BC, and Jeff's church has between 175 and 200 people in it right now that have been stuck and can't get home. I've got a friend that can't get home from the coast. We've got the school in Hope is full of people. There's still people trapped. So I'm going to say a prayer for BC. If you guys could pray with me, that would be a good thing. We pray, Lord God, for BC, and we thank you that you know people's suffering and pain, and that you walked with us in our pain, Jesus. And I pray for our province. I ask you to protect everybody in the day that they have ahead of themselves. We ask you, Lord, that you could show us how to help people. We pray, Lord, for those we love, that they would make it home safe, and that, Father God, you'd give the churches and government agencies wisdom on how to help people, because they need it. In Jesus' name, amen. Hard to understand this stuff, isn't it? And that's exactly why I've got this devotion by Tim Keller today. It's so appropriate for what we're going through with the pandemic and with people suffering in our province right now. So this is Pastor Tim Keller and his talk today. Let me just do that. Here we go.
Let me read just two verses from Psalm 11, verses 3 and 4. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. This is an excellent psalm for panicky times. In the first three verses, counselors have come to David, the king, and they've said, you've got to flee. The foundations are being destroyed. There are assassins about. People have infiltrated the palace. There's going to be a coup. And so you just need to get out of town. David, however, knows that as the king, the worst thing he could do for his people was to just flee. And therefore, he refuses to panic. And in verse 4, he explains exactly how he is able to avoid panic. He says two things. He says, the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. That's a reason for the mind and a reason for the heart that keeps you from panic. Let's do the reason for the mind first. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. Now, God is ruling the world. There is a plan. That's what David is reminding himself of. We modern people especially, are like the child in a car who's got a little toy steering wheel that he attaches to the glove compartment. He thinks he's steering the car, even though the parent, of course, is actually steering the car. And we are like that, especially we modern people, because we think that we're in control of the world, and therefore, if the world gets out of control, then the world is out of control. If we can't control it, then it's out of control. However, God is always in control. There's always a plan. Now, this is not a comforting idea. It's not a comforting idea unless there's a little bit of humility. I remember when we were moving from Philadelphia to New York City many, many years ago, and our children were very young. And I do remember talking to one of the children who was very upset about the fact they were going to leave their playmates behind. And it's very difficult when you're a 40-year-old to talk to a 5 or 6 or 7-year-old and explain, yeah, you won't have your playmate, but we're going to a way better place. You're going to have a way better life. We're going to have terrific stuff that's going to happen to us. But there's almost no way for a 40-year-old to say to a little child something that would console him at that time. Now, the difference between God and you and me is infinitely greater than the difference between a 40-year-old and a 4 or 5, 6-year-old. And therefore, when God, in a sense, comes and says, there are some things happening right now, but I want you to know there is a plan. There is some way in which, in the long run, I am working everything out for my glory and for your good. We don't understand it any more than the little child does. But here's the thing. You will get no consolation from the idea that God is in control if you don't humble yourself to say, I am a child. And of course, there might be some things that God would know that I wouldn't know. And so, first of all, if you're willing to humble yourself like that, then the idea that God is on his heavenly throne, that is a that's something for your mind that will calm your mind. But then there's also something for your heart. The Lord is in his holy temple. See, the throne of God is infinitely remote. It's up there. But the temple is here with us, and the temple was the way for you to have fellowship with God. And even in David's day, there was a temple. You could go to the temple. Psalm 27, David says, I go to the temple to see the Lord's beauty. But in the Old Testament, the reality was, if you were a worshiper, you never did see the Lord. You didn't see his glory. You weren't right in his presence, because that was behind the veil, and that was over the mercy seat. And the only person who was able to go back into the Holy of Holies was the priest, high priest, once a year on Yom Kippur, taking the blood of the atoning sacrifice. And so really, you didn't actually have that kind of access. You weren't able to really get into his presence. You weren't able to really sense his love on your heart. But now you suddenly get to the New Testament and something has changed. Because in the Old Testament, Moses said, show me your glory. And God says, I can't, it will kill you. But in John chapter 1, it says about Jesus Christ, we beheld his glory. Glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. How could that be? Well, the answer is when Jesus cast the money changers out of the temple in John chapter 2. He said, tear this temple down and I'll build it back up in 3 days. And he was talking about his body. And what does that mean? What he's saying is, I'm the temple. I'm the bridge between deity and humanity. I am the great high priest. I am the great sacrifice. Because of my death on the cross, because I've paid for your sins, the veil in the temple was ripped from top to bottom. That's what the Bible says happened the moment he died. And now you can actually go right in and you can see his face, and you can sense his presence through prayer, through faith in the gospel, through the word of God, and you can actually know his presence, because the Lord is in his holy temple, and his holy temple is Jesus Christ himself, the final temple, the true temple. If you have that fellowship for your heart, if you've got that understanding of God's sovereignty for your head, you can face anything.
So, let me flip this around. Tim started glitching there at the end. It's a good thing he's done his talk. So, it's good to know that God is in control, and also that he came down here to walk with us through this pain. When someone's hurting, that's a hard thing for us to grasp. But point them to the cross is that even in our pain, Christianity is the only religion where the God of our religion suffered with us, who came down to ultimately suffer in our place. So he does know what it's like to suffer and to be human. But in the middle of it, just love and help the people that are hurting. So that's what we want to do. And we want to remember the truth of John 3:16, that in the middle of our muck and in the middle of our mire and our inability to fix ourselves and save ourselves, Jesus came, God so loved the world that he came down to help us out. This is We the Kingdom and some words and their song, God So Loved the World.
This next song is called God So Loved. It's our most recent song that we have as our radio single right now. And we love this song. I feel like this song is so grounding for us. Whenever I sing it, I just feel like my heart can freely and truly worship the Lord for his perfect and his unending, his everlasting love for us that is not dependent on the good things that we do or the bad things that we do. He just loves us because he loves us. And I love that when he looks at us, he sees Jesus. He sees his son, his righteous son, his perfect son. He doesn't see all of our past or our shame or our struggles. I love this part in the song. It says, bring all your failures, bring your addictions, and come lay them down at the foot of the cross. And I think sometimes we have this idea in our head that we have to clean ourselves up in order to come to Jesus. But that is not the gospel at all. Like, he wants us to bring all of our pain, all of our failures to him so that he can welcome us into his arms and love on us and let his love come inside our hearts so that it changes us. And I love that. I love this song. And I encourage you guys, as you listen, that you would just let your heart worship.
Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
if you're hurting and our province is hurting right now, if you're confused that God loves you, he's going to get you through it. Just like he's going to get me through this cold that's taken away my voice and my energy. But God is with us through the good and the bad times. We can't forget his love that endured the cross and rose again from the dead. God said, the spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you and me. So we're going to be just fine. I'm going to pray for you. God, I pray for me and for everybody else watching that, Lord, their day would be full of hope, that they would know that because you love the world, you saved us. We pray for our hurting province. We ask you, God, again, the flood waters would recede for the people in Merritt, in Agassiz, in Chilliwack, in Abbotsford, and all those people have lost their houses, their cars, that they would not lose their lives and that you protect them, Jesus. And help the helpers, we pray. Send your angels to help them and help the churches and the government agencies that are helping. And bless Pastor Jeff in the town of Hope and give him grace as he helps take care of people there. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys have a great day ahead of you. The Lord's with you.